Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Leschowitz Recital Hall. At this time, we ask that you please silence your electronic devices and locate the nearest exit in the event of an emergency. Please note that food, drink, and flash photography are not permitted in the hall. Thank you and enjoy the performance.
If this is your first experience with the Baroque music in the, on the period instruments, then you're in for a treat. Because we're hoping to bring the old music to you in the new style. What I mean is that most of the, what we are reading from actually is from the manuscript or facsimile, which is the handwriting from the composer or copyist. It gives a little bit more of a personal connection when we read those music. And all those music, it does not give you so much information. The most, you probably have a little bit of a forte piano here and there. There's no crescendo, it doesn't really tell you much. But what it does for us is that we look at the treatise, use those information, have a discussion, and then it gives us so much imagination that how we want to put the music together and present for you. So I hope that you enjoy today's concert. If you have questions and afterwards, I welcome you and then encourage you to talk to the musician here, because for me, I always feel like the curious, being curious is the first step of learning. Now I would like Theresa to talk about the Baroque violin here.
Hello and welcome everybody. I'm Theresa Salomon and I teach Baroque violin and Baroque ensemble here. And just a few words about what makes this instrument different of your normal violin or viola. So you probably can't really see that, but the first thing you could see is that I'm not using a chin rest or a shoulder rest. You see that the bow is different. It's shorter and it's very pointy. Its weight is much less than a modern bow. It does other things well than a modern bow. I'm playing on plain gut strings. The tailpiece is different, it's flatter. The bridge is different, it's not as high. So the whole instrument doesn't have as much tension as modern instruments tend to have. The sound post is thinner. And it makes it different. It speaks differently. It doesn't immediately react as our modern strings. It has a little more material in the sound, if you want. So the bigger question is, why do we do that? Why do we want to go back? Isn't this, the modern violin an improvement? And in many ways it is, but it's like many other things. We tend to view the passage of time as only progress, and while there's lots of progress, there's also things that get lost, like something is gained, something is lost, and with the tools that were available to the composers when they wrote the music, it gets us a little bit closer to their world and to what was available to them, and also what was important to them. Like the biggest example that I always use is they weren't really after the long, endless melodies yet in the 17th and 18th century. when the bows are shorter, they do very detailed things really well. They don't do like huge, big, long melodies that well. That's one example. But so in that sense, that's why we want to recover that and make that music as lively and as fresh as when it was written. All right.
Thank you. Thank you. completely different when Baroque musicians talked about Baroque music was the difference between Italian music and French music. Just as Italian music was becoming all the rage in like the 17 teens, Mr. Corelli's and his followers, the other composers you're hearing on this program, Wright published his third book of pieces for viola da gamba. And so we're going to do one of those, G major. Now, if any of you have the idea that the viola da gamba was somehow the ancestor of the cello, or the viola da gamba family, the ancestor of the violin family, let me disabuse you of that thought right now. The two families came into being in recognizable sort of final form around the beginning of the 16th century in Italy, around the same time. The viols fell out of favor, you know, by the end of the 18th century, and so the modern orchestras don't have them. But they're a little bit different from the violin. They have a tuning that's a bit more like a lute or a guitar. They have usually flat rather than hard backs, and a sort of more resonant sound, so that chords sustain on them. And they have frets that help with that, adjustable frets, the same as other fretted instruments of the time. So, I mentioned flat back, belly. Many of them have different shaped C halls. This is a copy of an instrument by Steiner, Jacob Steiner, from Absam in what is present-day Austria, just down the valley a little bit from Innsbruck. And he studied making in Italy in Cremona, we think, maybe with the Mahdi, and made instruments that were actually valued more highly than those second choices of the Mahdis and Guarneri's and Stradivari's until the 19th century. That's a whole different story for another time. Anyway, go to this thing. Jason's going to tell you a little bit about the theorbo.
Yes, the instrument I'm using predominantly, well, exclusively in this program, is the theorbo. And basically, you can see it's obviously very shocking the size, but it's of the lute family, and so a lot of people sort of think of the lute as the predecessor to the guitar, but actually the lute and the guitar existed at the same time. They just had different repertoire, and so this was of the lute family. And one of the most prominent differences is you see the rounded back that these instruments have. And so this was the most common lute in the 17th century, and you can see it took a couple minutes to retune. This is all gut strings on this instrument, as you know. I think all the instruments in this program tonight, the violins and the viol, and so which is very fussy when it comes to humidity and temperature.
Jason and I, between us, have four more strings than the rest of the instruments in the program combined, excepting the harpsichord.
And so, one of the other big differences with this instrument, and also the guitars were the same in the 17th, 16th, 17th, 18th century. These frets are tied on, so these are actually movable frets, and that's because at the time there wasn't a general tuning system that everybody used. Everybody had their own tuning systems based on Pythagorean tuning system or the mean tone tuning system. So, anyway, this allows me to adjust a little bit. To what I'm playing. So, and as far as the stylistically, what I'm doing in this program, which is very common with this instrument, I'm playing from a bass line, and I'm improvising the harmonies above the bass. It's the same thing that the harpsichordist would do, and it's the same part that a cellist would read from as well.
Thank you. Stadoise. Ils sont tous fous, les Anglais. The shots, hunting horns. You'll hear where they come in. Thank you.
maybe, you know, actually my cello is from 1793, so it's just a little bit older than this music would have been. One day perhaps we will have a true Baroque setup, but for the meantime, like I say, we're a bit of an imposter. But we're going to enjoy this music nonetheless. So one of the things I've been thinking about a lot recently in my professional life as a performer is sort of why is certain music played on the concert stages more than others, right? Like whether it's, a big topic right now is the composers from underrepresented backgrounds. But I also think that there are these amazing composers throughout the history who, for whatever reason, don't seem to get played as much. Certainly in my experience as a cellist, a teacher, and a performer, there are many Baroque pieces that are kind of known as study pieces. So, before Casals, the 6 cello suites by Bach were considered study pieces. They were the equivalent now of what we consider proper etudes, which is kind of crazy. And so I think a lot of us are more familiar with the sonatas of Vivaldi and Corelli and Marcello. We see these more as when we're sort of intermediate stage cellists, and I think Jim and Yanni's kind of fallen through the cracks a little bit because his music is a touch harder than those, a little bit more unexpected in terms of turn of the phrase or the harmonies. But it's been really a delight to get to know this sonata of his, and we look forward to sharing.
Thank you.
As you hear the harpsichord, and you probably can tell the difference between that and the piano, is that there's a plucking sound. And this is what is the inside of my instrument, and I'm giving the, for you to see better, have a bigger vision. So instead of that, you have a bird quill that pluck in the string and come back. And as you can imagine, as a guitar, once you pluck it, there's no dynamics, right? You get what you get. So for us to have imagination for loud and soft to accompany the so-called melodic line, that we play even either more notes or less notes to give you a kind of a sound that have a bigger sound or soft. And then people say, oh, it's a plucking, so that you probably don't, you can't play legato. Well, it's not really the case, because we can sustain as much as we can. And same as saying, you know, how the harp sound, you actually you can be as legato as you you want in there. And so another thing I want to talk about the next piece the word playing is that usually we for the ensemble or for music, we say, oh, let's go to a rehearsal. You don't usually hear that, hey, let's come in and jam the music, right? That's usually like maybe in jazz music you hear that. I hope like the next piece we're going to present you is a folia. It's really the music that is in the drum bass, 8 bars and repeated. And the bass line just repeating and has the, is in the dance, and that melodic line, they improvise their own. That's how it started it. But of course, in this piece that we're not really improvising, although the violence, Theresa will be. So the music, you're going to hear a lot of interaction between the instruments and also on the bass as well. So hopefully that can set you off with a good energy, and then you should feel like you want to join and I want to stand up at the end too, because that's how much energy that you're going to hear at the end. So enjoy the last piece.
Actually, the joke is a lute player spends half their life tuning and the other half playing out of tune.